Universities are on the verge of an apocalyptic and terminal collapse. At least that's what you'd have to believe if you went to a bookstore and looked under the education section at the titles. By my count, in the last couple of years, there have been 39 books written on the demise of the North American university. These attacks come from the political left, and they come from the political right. They come from inside the academy and outside the academy. I reviewed a couple of these books a few months back for the international science magazine Nature, and I began my review as follows. Universities today are fractious places, populated by customers, formerly known as students, who play increasingly large amounts of mostly borrowed money in exchange for high grades from researchers with large frequent flyer mile accounts, formerly known as professors, who report to real estate developers, formerly known as university presidents. Now, this, of course, is a caricature, but as in most caricatures, it conveys elements of truth. One of the many problems of the modern university is that they have taken on, or perhaps had imposed on them by society, too many goals. Universities are supposed to be triggers of urban renewal and engines of economic growth. They're supposed to cure sick people. They're supposed to generate new knowledge and train the next generation of scholars and, if possible, spin off biotech companies in the process. They're supposed to provide an endless supply of talking heads for the 24/7 news cycle. Now, all of these things, with the possible exception of the talking heads, are social goods. There's nothing wrong with economic development or certainly curing sick people or generating new knowledge. But they have created a culture in which the language tells it all. You talk to any university faculty member, and they will tell you about their teaching load and their research opportunities. And being mostly rational people, they attempt to minimize their loads and maximize their opportunities. Thus, we have a reward system with multiple levels of faculty, assistant professors, associate professors, full professors, chaired professors, and then in some institutions, university professors. They are at the top of the pinnacle, 0.1% of the distinguished faculty. And you know what the distinguishing feature of a university professor is? They never have to teach again. So the problem with these multiple roles and this culture is that they're inimical to the purpose for which universities were founded, and that is to educate young people. And they use educate in the sense of its Latin root, educatus educare. It does not mean to pour bits of information from my full vessel into your empty vessels. What it means is to open up and lead forth, to open up minds to new perspectives and then lead them forth to a lifetime of learning. I think to describe where universities are today, I can do it by a story that really encapsulates the problem that occurred to me a few years ago in my American university. I had the opportunity to go and teach a class of fourth graders. I'm an astrophysicist, and so I talked about the universe. I showed them beautiful Hubble pictures. I waxed eloquent about black holes and the cosmic background radiation. And at the end, there were about 80 fourth graders in the room. There were 160 hands in the air, right? Everybody had a question. In fact, everybody had two questions, one with each hand. And it went on and on and on, and they just were insatiable. They were finally, you know, dragged out by their shirt collars by the teacher to go to lunch. They were still asking questions. And then I took the bus back to my 4 o'clock seminar with first-year students, a seminar in science that all students have to take at my university. And I only had 20 of them in the room. I walked in a few minutes before class, and, you know, it was the usual situation. Two of them were texting, three of them were on Facebook, a couple of them were asleep. But the rest had their pads at exactly the right angle. They had their pens poised, and you could read what was behind their eyes. Okay, so in an hour and 55 minutes, this seminar will be over. And 5 more of these seminars, and my first term will be over, and I'll be 1/8 of my way to Harvard Law School. Sir Ken talked about the linear approach to education that we have. These students have bought into it. They're on a road, there's some hurdles they have to jump, and they'll keep going in a straight line. We were going to discuss this fascinating article on the neuroscience of the brain. And I looked at them and I said, why aren't you more like fourth graders? Being first year students, not recognizing a rhetorical question, 5 hands went up. So with some trepidation, I called on the first young woman in the front and I said, she said, well, Professor Helfand, you have to understand. when you're in fourth grade, you're curious about something, you ask a question. But by the time you get to our age, 17 we're talking about, by the time you get to our age, you know there's sort of an infinite amount of stuff to know, and it's all on Google anyway, so what's the point of asking a question? Which the appropriate response is, what's the point of not shooting yourself? But I didn't say that. I called on the next young man, and he said, well, Professor Helfand, you have to understand. I'm not making this up, by the way. This is a true story. He said, you have to understand this is a seminar. And I said, yeah, that's why we're in this small little room with the chairs around so we can talk to each other. He said, yes, but you have to understand the point of being here is to come out on top and beat the competition. And asking a question is a sign of weakness. So in seminars, you only make statements. You never ask questions. In a lecture where you're anonymous, you can raise your hand and ask a question. But in the seminar, you only make statements. Well, I'm an obstreperous guy, so I kept going, you know. I called on the next two people, and it was just as grim. And finally, there was the fifth one who was sitting in the front, and he was sort of sitting there like this, and he was watching this go back and forth. And he finally did this, and I said, yes? He said, Professor Helfand, what I think you're missing here is I'm paying for a degree, not for an education. Oh, you groaned, so there's hope. That's good. And I think that sums it up. They're paying for a degree and not for an education. And who can blame them for this cynicism when the entire structure of universities is set up to reinforce it? So as you can imagine, I was intrigued by the concept of starting with a completely blank slate and creating a university for the 21st century. A university that will allow its graduates to face the daunting problems that this century holds for them, that equips them with tools to do that, and is also aimed at them, at digital natives immersed in a culture that celebrates multitasking. So what would we have to do to design a university from scratch? Well, first of all, you have to forget almost everything you know about universities and think about what you need to do. Number one, you need to set goals for your university. Number two, you need an institutional structure for your university. Number three, you need a curriculum for your university. And number four, you need a way to deliver that curriculum to meet your goals. So what did we do? We created something, not very far from here, called Quest University Canada. The goal was simple. Rather than that multiplicity of goals that other universities take on, we had one, and that was to educate undergraduates, to open up and lead forth their minds. So that was done, check. Now, institutional structure. Well, there we do have to take lessons from what exists in universities today. All modern universities are designed on the basis of the 19th century German model of the modern university. Now, I'm not sure what they were thinking in Germany in the 19th century, but it must have gone something like this. Okay, so we've got this group of experts in some particular field over here, and they work really well together. And then we've got this other group of experts in a different field over here, and there's a third group of experts in a different field over here. And so what we'll do is bring them all together on one field, a campus, we'll put them next to each other, and we'll see what happens. Well, we found out. So they build these silos around, right? And the more energetic ones build the really tall silos so they can throw rocks down on the little silos around them and stage raiding parties at night to steal their resources. These are called departments in universities. And they're populated by PhDs. Now, you know the process of getting a PhD is learning more and more about less and less until you know absolutely everything about nothing. And the problem is, when you put all these people who know the same thing about the same nothing together, there's not a lot of motivation for them to interact with each other, except to steal the other guy's resources. So the first organizing principle of our institution is no departments. And we built it into the concrete by building a circular academic building, so there's no edges and boundaries, and by assigning the offices to faculty by lottery. So a mathematician sits next to a music professor, who sits next to an economist, who sits next to a neuroscientist, who sits next to a philosopher, and on the other side, there's a poet and a physicist. And guess what? When you choose carefully, these people who went through that funnel of learning more and more about less and less remember why they liked academia in the first place, and that's because they like learning new things, and they come out the other side, and you end up with our enumerate music professor and our tone-deaf mathematician collaborating on a course called The Mathematics of Music, where in the classroom, they are modeling learning for the students because they're actually learning. We furthermore think the hierarchies of my five levels of professors is not particularly helpful, and so we have no faculty ranks. And everyone, including myself, has exactly the same size office, teaches exactly the same amount. teaches the same set of courses for first-year students through fourth-year students. Also, since we don't do what I'm doing here, we don't engage in this demonstrably ineffective mode of communication called lecturing, we don't profess, so we don't call ourselves professors. We actually teach, so we call ourselves tutors. And we build into the classroom the kind of environment for which our brains have evolved, which is two-way communication. So we have no lecture hall on the campus at all. Every classroom is an oval seminar table with 21 chairs around it. Never more than 21, so one faculty member and 20 students, or in the case of the mathematics of music, two faculty members and 18 students. This changes a lot. But then there's the curriculum. What would we teach? Well, those of us involved in founding this university are very devoted to the notion of the liberal arts and sciences curriculum. Liberal comes from libre, which means free. It's what free people do. They think about subjects, and they think about them across the spectrum. And so the curriculum we designed involves the faculty over the first 2 years of the student's education specifying what they will do. They will all take mathematics, they will all take biology, they will all take poetry, they will all take economics. They will take a set of 16 courses in broad disciplines and interdisciplinary in nature, which will open their minds to the intellectual tools that different disciplines have developed so they can synthesize those tools into a way of addressing the complex problems which are not going to be solved from a disciplinary perspective. But then we think it's time, having equipped them with these tools, to turn their education over to them. And so near the end of the second year, every group of students, 15 of them, get together with a faculty member and spend an entire month developing an individualized question, something about which they want to know, a question about the world. And in developing this question, they find a mentor, a single faculty member with whom they're going to work for the next 2.5 years. They define a set of books, seminal works, they're going to read with that faculty member and discuss to understand the basis of the field. They select a set of courses that's going to help inform their question. They define an experiential learning component, which is required of all students, to go out into the real world, into a research laboratory, into a K-12 classroom, into an NGO in Kenya, into a local community organization, into a government office, to see how the real world functions when dealing with issues related to the question the student has. And then at the end of their 4 years, they do a project that doesn't necessarily answer the question. Some of them are very broad, but arise out of the question and produce a document which, having seen many master's theses in Ivy League universities, exceeds them almost every time, and then presents to the entire university the product of their undergraduate education. That's three. Four was, how do we deliver this? And here we borrowed, shamelessly, from Colorado College. And we decided to confront this neurophysical nonsense of multitasking head on. Your prefrontal cortex does not multitask. It does one thing at a time. Unlike your laptop, which has four cores and can do four things at a time, your prefrontal cortex can only do one, which is why driving, talking on your cell phone, and texting at the same time is good for the gene pool, because you will die and you'll be removed, and we won't have to worry about this multitasking in 50 years in the future. And so what we do, rather than have students take four or five or six classes at a time, which means they devote a few minutes, or maybe if you're lucky, a few hours a week to each class, and you, as the tutor, gets to see them 75 minutes twice a week, the students take four courses in a semester, but they take them in series rather than in parallel, what we call blocks. You walk in the classroom, and you have nothing else to do for the month, and the students have nothing else to do for the month. So if you want to go on a field trip, you don't have to worry about getting back in time for their chemistry lab in the afternoon or the fact they have an English paper due the next day, because they don't. They're yours. I'm an astronomer. If I want to keep them up all night for 18 hours, not a problem, because that's all they're doing is astronomy. If you want to teach them international economic development, you could do that in a classroom in BC out of a textbook, or you could send them to Belize for 3.5 weeks and teach the course there. That's the mode we operate in. It's called the block system. And every academic I've spoken to about it says, well, I see how that would work in your field, but it won't work in my field. Everyone except the 40 tutors at Quest, none of whom will ever go back to teaching any other way because this is so extraordinarily effective. And I'll give you one example, because I only have 2 minutes left, rather than the 100 that I could. Every student at Quest in their first year has to take a math course. But the point of the math course and all the other of the foundation courses is not to pour knowledge from the full vessel to the empty one, not to gain a set of facts which you can find easily with Google, as my students so eloquently said, but it is to show by example how a mathematician asks questions about the world and goes about trying to answer them, and how a philosopher does that, and how a poet does that, and how a physicist does that, so they can accumulate those tools and apply them to their unique interests. So everyone takes a math class, and one of the math classes is spherical trigonometry. How many people have had spherical trigonometry? That's what I thought, because it's not taught in any university in North America except ours. And the reason it's taught there is because our math tutor, a remarkable pedagogue, loves spherical trigonometry. His book came out with Princeton University Press 2 months ago on spherical trigonometry. This was a huge development in the 19th century, because after all, we do live on a sphere. And it turns out trigonometry is different on a sphere, and so your GPS would not work at all unless it understood spherical trigonometry, and therefore you don't have to. But in the 19th century, this was important for navigation and for surveying. And so Glenn teaches spherical trigonometry, and this class becomes a cult. They get these Lucite spheres so they can draw, and they carry them around like pet rocks. You know, take them to the cafeteria, show their friends how to do this trigonometry. And 2 Decembers ago, a remarkable thing happened. Glenn has taught this class in 3 universities, 6 or 7 other times. He had a group of 18 first-year students in their 4th month of university. None of them were going to be math majors. We don't have math majors because we don't have departments, but nonetheless, none of them were particularly interested in math. This just course has a reputation, so the kids all signed up for it. And on the 9th day of class, Glenn presented a theorem first published in 1807, reproduced in every textbook ever since, and in his forthcoming book at that time with Princeton University Press. And by the end of the 3-hour class, the students had found a logical flaw in the proof that had escaped mathematicians for 200 years. Which meant Glenn had to withdraw his galley proofs, fix it, and acknowledge his class in the acknowledgments for having advanced the field of spherical trigonometry as a bunch of first-year non-math major students. That's the level of analytical ability one can cultivate. That's the level of engagement one gets in this regard. It's actually, I must confess, not a completely original idea. 2,500 years ago, Confucius summed it up succinctly, as usual. Tell me, and I'll forget. Show me, and I'll remember. Involve me, and I'll understand. Tell me, and I'll forget. The model of the modern university lecture. And the ultra-modern MOOC, even better. Show me, and I'll remember. I don't think he had glitzy PowerPoint presentations in mind there, but maybe he did. Involve me. Involve me in an environment enriched by contrasting cultural perspectives, enabled by the ability to draw tools from multiple intellectual disciplines, and facilitated by effective and persuasive communication, and I will understand. Involve me in a setting where lateral thinking is rewarded, where collaboration rather than competition is celebrated, and where failure is understood to be essential on the road to success. Involve me, and I will understand. So to educate, that's the only goal we have at our university, to open up young minds and lead them forth so that they have the tools, the capacity, the will, the grit to confront and to conquer the daunting challenges this new millennium presents. Thank you.